First of all, it's always a great pleasure for the Oliver Wyman team to be able to come up here and present our research from the year. Frankly, the feedback you give us over coffee and drinks later on through the conference is pretty valuable. So don't hold back. We're tough. We can take it. More specifically, and Hatch isn't here, there's a malicious rumor that I'm the Doom Machine or Dr. Doom or... I want to take that on straight on. Our team is involved in freight railroads today on four continents. We are out there fighting every day to grow the business. It is not our desire to see railroads not achieve. That said, because many of you work so closely with us, when we come to speak on this, we're speaking from a fact base that many of your teams are actually already working on. That said, we get to be the person that gets to talk about it. So, where Mr. Hatch went, I am not Dr. Doom. But anyway, let's jump into it. So today, the focus is gonna be on carload, which apparently everyone wants to talk about. And our position on this one is really that carload represents both an opportunity or in a point of inflection, depending on how we manage it. So we called it the canary for the railroad, in the sense that the choices we make in carload will probably define the business model that we have in the future, and let me explain why. The very first is relevance. Carload keeps all the capillaries of our network alive. It's hard to imagine we would have got frac sand at the level we did if we didn't have the coverage we did. So God knows what's coming next, but if we don't have the capillaries, we can't be relevant to that other 92% of the transportation market we don't have. And we can thank carload for preserving that. Second, growth. Carload is probably the stepchild of the industry. We've done so well on intermodal and so well on bulk to get those systems cleaned up, well-funded, well-structured, the business models are robust. And carload is still that complicated thing that we all struggle with, but it has relatively weak market share, and it's packed full of opportunities to reduce either costs or improve service. So it's the new frontier, and depending on how we respond to that, we're going. And if we don't continue the transformation we have in carload, it's our opinion that that will risk where the rail model goes, particularly as coal disappears off the network. So let's go to the competitive context. PSR and its siblings, for those who aren't doing PSR, that's for a couple of friends. Anyway, so there's lots of things we could talk about, the good and bad, but fundamentally we do have a lower cost base in carload. We've done a wonderful job focusing, here's Mr. Hatch. Anyway, we've done a lovely job focusing on dwell. We've pushed over 100,000 cars off the network for the same volume, and we've done a lovely job levering the network capacities. Many of the short lines are collaborating, and many clients are collaborating by pre-blocking traffic. We're now sharing train capacities and corridors to get higher efficiencies and higher velocities. It's wonderful. We would argue, though, that on the supply chain integration side, we're still fairly weak. There are moments of brilliance in every carrier, and a number of the short line companies are doing some pretty incredible stuff. But as comprehensive as PSR has been in the industry, the commercial side hasn't been there. And it's kind of ironic because we have this wonderful capacity dividend that we could take on that has almost no requirement for CapEx to grow. We've got the yards, we've got the cars, we've got the engines. It's now that time. And we've got the opportunity to be a little more consistent in our service offering and frequency. So we are best as an industry. If you look over our history, when our back's against the wall, we tend to be our most innovative. And one could argue we're starting to get our back against the wall as coal's going away and we're finding ourselves with weak volumes in structural products like intermodal for the first time in a very long time. Mm-hmm. So we hope this inspires the innovation and the chance-taking that takes to grow the business. And again, we reinforce, as we're working with all of you, you have the assets in place to do much of this at a relatively low cost. You can test new models at a relatively low cost. This is not somewhere where you have to go and build a $100 million terminal to test out something. And because we have so many assets sitting on the ground, we can do it quickly. Now, the other great thing is we're well aligned with our customers. As we work in other divisions of All or One, customers are super keen to take costs out of their supply chain to compete globally. It's what we want to do. We're well aligned. The problem is we're struggling to find a comprehensive way to do it compared to how fast we move on something like PSR. So the Dr. Doom part, that's what you're out of the room for. We do need to have a bit of a conversation about some of the risks that are still coming. So when I spoke to you about a year ago, I told you the commercial wholesale offer for energy had dropped to 3 cents a kilowatt hour. It's just dropped to 2 cents a kilowatt hour, actually 1.997 out of LA. That beat everything in terms of the opportunity to build gas plants or run coal plants. This is fairly structural and fairly important because it was privately funded and done under a franchise. So private money is moving into this area quite quickly, and they're trying to enable it. And it's such a structural lower cost, we need to understand what that does. So electric vehicles, what this chart on the right-hand side shows you is kind of the learned white papers at the moment on what is the conversion rate of diesel requirements to move a kilometer or mile of traffic versus the electrical. And last year we showed you, and I think everyone knows it, this is effectively a steam to diesel transition, right? We get in the order of 30% and change of the energy out of diesel into tractive effort, and we're getting about 86 to 88% out of a battery. That's what you see in this chart. It just, there are a lot of things in the way, to be sure. We got to get better batteries, got to get distance. But the point is, the fundamental draw for everyone is the fact that this is structurally cheaper on the energy input side and how fast you convert it. It gets worse when you turn it into the gas or the diesel cost and into the energy cost. So you take a look at this chart again on the right, and wow, that just dropped down even further. So happily, batteries are expensive and new tech is expensive, so slow it down a little bit. But I point out that's at 10 cents a kilowatt hour. That's the retail offer. And somebody's out there producing the wholesale at 2 cents a kilowatt hour. You touch those two lines together, and the energy price gets very cheaper. So there's a manufacturer out there who believes in energy vehicles and made a bold statement that he was going to beat rail intermodal. And some of my colleagues chuckled. We had a couple beers over it. And when you move to 2 cents a kilowatt hour, it all of a sudden it's like, well, maybe that's credible. Because if they can supply themselves, what does that even look like? So our caution here is when we meet with many of you, you want to talk about driverless trucks. Because we put this chart up and got the label from Hatch that we're Dr. Doom. The reality is, and we said in that session, and we're going to reinforce it again, it is about the energy. It is not about the labor yet. So this first time when we introduced it, we talked about super truck was a much more efficient diesel truck. Now we're seeing a situation with much more efficient energy conversion in the trucking, and that is an immediate issue that we have to pay attention to. And it's getting more real. So to what the panel said earlier today, rail's well positioned to be a bit of a golden child in the market if we just understand how to market ourselves as that. So Walmart, I think most of you know Walmart, has a project called Project Gigaton, and that is they're trying to take a gigaton of carbon out of their supply chain partners. Rail's a great way to do that, but the point is, this is not be driven because they're just in themselves nice people. The consumer market's looking for them to be much more green. As well, not as good for us, is they want to be 50% renewable energy by 2025. So that's pretty big. It does get a little bit worse. So Amazon, just a week and a half ago, revealed that they've ordered 100,000 electric trucks to start delivery in 2021 that they're investing $10 billion in. If you were looking for the gateway drug for commercialization of electric trucks, this is it. And it's not Tesla, it's Rivian. So, you know, everyone wants to talk about Elon, and Elon's a great poster child for a whole bunch of things. But we would like again to reinforce, the issue is not the driverless truck. The issue is competing on the energy inputs and the rate this gets adopted. So there are many things, because everyone's trying to get more green, as the panel said, that are very good for us and we need to capitalize on, but we can't turn a blind eye to what's happening in the total renewable situation. So how do we respond? So I got some pretty strong feedback from a few of you about this chart on the left, but we loaded up the US DOT forecast to 2045, and I'm not a forecaster, never want to be one, but I pulled theirs, and you got a lot of really smart people in America who produced this. And basically, we put the S2B diversion model against it and said, don't worry, rail's not going out of business, but it's not going to participate in the growth. What we lose in coal will fill with something else, but net-net will be about the same business we are today, which arguably is okay. I mean, many of our young people will still be employed actively in the industry, but the point is we're not going to participate in the growth. And, you know, if you take a look at the general merchandise business, which is the chart on the right, that attractive market level is actually going up. And we're not poised to participate in that unless we structurally change our market offer. And this is a cost-sensitive model, not a price-sensitive model. So if we are able to move price or cost out of the supply chain, that red line is going to climb. And there's a lot of it in front of us. I mean, we said 8% out of the whole market. That's a reasonable number. And our concern is that people don't understand that we need to do a general lift in carload, not just one-off. So let's talk about a couple of examples of how we might take a better look at products we're already running today that we could do a little bit better on. So grain. I think everyone knows what grain is. You know, we have very strong market share. It's just short of $9 billion revenue for us, and it's 1.5 million carloads. So, not bad. It takes over 250 railroads to move grain. So it's pretty important, a whole bunch of us. Interestingly, there's 1,800 locations it gets originated on the rail network, and it goes to 1,100 destinations. That pretty much says it's a network business. You don't have the network, you don't have the business. Back to the capillary problem. And it's almost complete coverage of the North American network. So grain is an important thing to us. Interestingly, we need almost 300,000 cars to move it though, for only 1.5 million loads. So supply chain, that's kind of weird, because we're starting to lose market share in grain. And it is this, if there's a commodity to build for rail, this is it. Growth is solid, you know, yields are up, more stuff's being planted, this year being a bit of an exception with Lake Nebraska. The stock turns on this is once per year. Gets harvested in August, September, goes into an elevator. We know what it is. We have multiple channels, multiple offers. So we're very good at figuring out how to do. We've built systems where we have multiple day notice on the order. And we generally provide a daily offer. So why are we losing market share when the conversion of a grain car to a truck is 3-to-1? And we know it's coming, and we have all the things in place to be a good supply chain partner. Well, as discussed earlier in the panel, it takes many partners to actually make the grain move happen, from a straight pricing and offer acceptance all the way to final delivery. The domestic market more and more would like to do small orders, so we are very good at export large, big trains. You know, to be a bit of a jerk on this, it astounds me that chickens that used to need 4,000 tons to keep them well fed now need 6,000 tons, because I thought the chicken ate the same stuff every day. So why have we changed? Why are we looking at this single market and trying to put it into once every 8-week services, right? I mean, that's fundamental. You know, I've got it at the very bottom there, let's go to it. Rail cars and the grain are getting about 10 loads a year. And you can imagine what that number looks like if you take out the fast moving bulk. Show me the tandem grain truck that gets 10 loads a year, right? What are we missing when we have everything oriented towards ourselves, aside from the lack of transparency across all the players in the supply chain, to keep it moving. Kill the dwell, win the business. So let's go to a different one. This one's a little tougher. So automotive, we have weak share and it's declining. I think all of us find that pretty extraordinary, considering we have such a premium product out there, in the sense you drive off the ramp, you go into an enclosed space, you can move safely across with very little bad handling anymore. We're very good at that. It gets into a nice facility, you open the doors, you drive it down, it's protected, and that compares to traveling down the interstate with whatever weather you're in. So if we've got such a good product, why are we losing market share? Well, it's not just us. And I really want to reinforce that. This eye chart on the side is just to show you the shipping pattern out of one of the auto assembly plants for one of the railroads we dealt with. And there's two things you get. First of all, averages are wonderful things, but railroads don't deliver averages. Railroads deliver individual shipments. And day by day, manufacturer was unable to stabilize production at a relatively similar rate of cars coming out of the facility, even though the assembly line is within the tolerance of 0.5% of it. So it's the base load isn't changing, it's just the choice to ship is being changed. And then the colors tell you where they're going. So some days you have it, some days you don't have it, some days you have too much of it. And this would be an example of us not being good collaborators on the supply chain. And what does that do? It just generates tons of dwell or really interrupted crappy service. So, I mean, you're all railroaders. So if I get 3,000 feet today of something I expected to be 1,000 feet, do I have the protected connection in Chicago for the other 2,000 feet? Probably not. So why can't we, where we have an assembly line that knows its production plan at least a week in advance, if not a month in advance, and many of these cars just moving to restock, why don't we see it coming? So, as always, I like to give you a good and a bad example. So the chart on the left is kind of a North American average, and the best observed is on the right, and one of our clients that we deal with. And what the chart shows is the number of days of dwell of either the rail car or the automobile as it moves through the system. So very quickly, starting at the bottom, you know, we kind of tend to mess around for a couple of 3 days, getting from the ramp to a road train on average. Weekends and a bunch of things play into that. At destination, we tend to again spend a day or two getting it placed. And then we spend well over a week in an empty status situation before the car. So I've taken all the transit out. This is just first and last mile. And then the vehicle sits on the ground typically about a week. So we have in the order of, you know, 14 days of dwell in the system for automobiles. And then I go over to the best observed, and this system's operating about 2 days. So why is the first and last mile so dramatically different? Well, the small guy, the better example, order visibility is there. You cannot ship if you haven't told 48 hours in advance exactly where the car is going. It's not like give me 25 auto decks, I'll tell you when you pick them up. It's I am going to send you 4 auto decks to LA tomorrow. The second, they pre-block it. That's not new to any of us. I mean, pre-blocking was happening, you know, after we've got like 4 cars on a train. So we understand how to pre-block, but the collaboration of the client means that car actually that set of cars flips immediately into a road train, and it's on its way, of which then it flips again. We are very good at block swapping, but we tend to not do it as much as we could, but this railroad does. And then what's best about it is, because I know 48 hours is coming, I'm going to tend to hold the block together and flip it through the system, it tends to be more stable. It's not always awesome, but it tends to be more stable, so we call it the no surprise arrival. So all vehicles coming off those auto cars go straight onto an auto truck to the dealership, as 90% of the vehicles in North America do that don't take a train, they follow that model. And because of that, this railroad holds market share that they shouldn't have. And frankly, market we wouldn't even touch. So the opportunity with us and automobiles is the first and last mile. We need to be integrated with those clients, and we need to find ways to simplify what we do from a supply chain model. So this has been said multiple times. So I'm going to add in all the inventory carrying costs to the numbers that were used on the panel earlier. So yellow box is rail. Again, it's a small piece of a very large system. And when we talk about supply chain and supply chain growth, often the first pivot is everyone goes for base volume. It's like, we just need more. Well, I think all of us would agree to that. In the truckload market, there's stuff we can go after that's just base volume, current model, do what you're doing, pick it up. I mean, many of our short lane partners do this every day. But the issue is, this box is really big. And this box holds interesting things like private rail cars, inventory carrying costs, financing, warehouses, short stock, retrucking, all those things that are around us. And I urge all of us, that's a pretty profitable and easy thing to do, and almost always asset light. It just takes information. And the information would make us more competitive. But the information requires us to be transparent across all the players in the industry. And if we only stay at the base volume question, we have opportunities. That's that chart I showed you before. We're going to lose coal, but we're going to basically stay the same. So we're going to get some of that base volume. We're going to be awesome if we can do some of the most rudimentary supply chain things. My caution for you is we're meeting people who are actually trying to monetize it against the industry. They're basically trying to monetize our bad service through better visibility and information. So what are we going to do? I've said it, I think, four times now. Transparency is critical. We need to know where the cars are and where they're going to be. There are many people who bemoan rail service sucks, and there are lots of parts of rail service that are rough. It's certainly better than it was for a while. Many of our clients don't actually need it to be on time at 95%, 15 minutes. What they do need us to be is it going to be here on Tuesday? The empty or the load, you know, to what you said, Chuck. That's the transparency piece. If people see it coming, they can react. Just as some of you are following your Amazon packages on UPS, if you see it coming, you know how to react. The next is the integration. We do need, as we've done well under PSR, we need to find a way to integrate across the supply chain and reach back into the shipment, not the rail car, the shipment, so that we can see it out of the warehouse into the final destination. And most importantly, as an industry, as we go around, we find you guys have a very strong shipper originator mindset as opposed to a very good receiver mindset. Supply chains are all about pull. They're not about push. So if you want to pull it, that person's called the receiver. And that person, we have to get in their head what they need to know so that they preference to use us for rail. The shippers we're very good at. We got that figured out. We know how to talk to them. What we really need to do is get the receivers. There's way more receivers than there are shippers. And that's our primary challenge. So, little self-congratulations here. Back in 2014, we talked about Rail Renaissance 2, trying to steal Tony's thunder. And we've seen a couple things happen. The convergence in planning is there. When we talked that time, most railroads had three planning organizations, Intermodal, Bulk, and Carload. Generally speaking, they have a single planning organization, and they're sharing train capacities to keep velocity up in certain markets. Resilience and operations, absolute real efforts with the supplier industry and the railroads to take away the exceptions. PTC has helped massively with this, but that investment hasn't stopped there. So what we're really hoping is, number one, is where we go next. If we can now conquer that animal, we really have a robust feel about the future, and I might even get rid of my Dr. Doom label for Mr. Hatch. So thank you very much.